Yasmine Sabri a un doctorat en architecture de l'Université du Caire et a fait ce doctorat sur le management de sites, sur la gestion des sites et le contrôle de ces sites. Et elle est actuellement professeure à la faculté d'ingénierie de l'Université de Zagazig en Égypte. Elle a 11 années d'expérience dans la pratique architecturale et le contrôle sur les sites, la supervision de travaux sur site, et la gestion de projets et le planning. Elle a une longue expérience et une très bonne compétence dans la conservation du patrimoine culturel et les projets de réhabilitation. Donc nous sommes dans le domaine du patrimoine bâti. Et elle va traiter d'un sujet très, très particulier et très intéressant, qui est celui de la gestion des collectivités, des communautés locales pour la conservation du patrimoine bâti vivant. Et dans les villes anciennes, avec comme cas d'étude particulier la vieille ville du Caire. Donc je vous passe la parole.
First of all, I'd like to thank TRC for the invitation. It's been an honor to be here. I will speak about local communities management in conserving livable World Heritage Cities. With case study about historic Cairo. The main problem of research is the absence of conservation policies which cause dangerous to the universal value. Heritage district as well, it need to perform its duty to the capital city, so the development is a little bit, will be very slow while we are working about livable World Heritage Cities. I will take theoretical approach first to outline the main issues connecting with community values inside. The concept of heritage was first for the local being like something, good legacy. So they consider heritage is good thing. So this is the thoughts of locals when we started to know about the historic city. After a while, after we connect with the communities, since centuries, I don't mean this nowadays, but since centuries we are communicated with communities. So after a while, finally, Egypt defined the legacy as a heritage law. It's called law number 117 or 117 for the year 1983. This here when we speak about antiquity. Antiquity was defined as finally in Egypt as immovable or immovable property that is a product of any of various civilization of art. And we all know that Egypt has layers of civilization. It's not only like we know that it's only pharaonic. No, it has layers of civilization. So this is the first time it was defined and be under the law. To have a regulation and instruction to be dealing with world heritage or architectural heritage. The ruling community, it was in shaping the heritage as the part we are calling scientifically intangible heritage. For the first point, first of all, we have to know what makes the place significant, and we have to let them understand and clarifying what the reason is significant. So when you are dealing with the, sorry, I will remove you from your shop to make something or to restore something because we have a livable site here. So you have to clarify to the community how it's important and why it's important. What is the historic evidence connected with? Through charters, of course, time after time, community values started to appear and started to be one by one. For example, Venice Charter, it's mainly to safeguard them no less as work of art, as historic evidence. And this start to appear even in our museum, so you will find a museum of a singer or a museum of a political character. So it started to be historic evidence, not only we are speaking about building, so this is the mix what we really wanted between the built heritage and the intangible heritage of community. Charter of Architectural Heritage, which were in Europe 1975, speak about a non-renewable resource of culture, spiritual, social, economic value. So now it's a part of our education, a part of our scientific reason to find a social value inside artistic or architectural value. While not a document of authenticity, it was very clear in multiplicity of values. It's not only one value or one side mirror. No, it has a lot of faces, so we have to find it all to know all about the Belt heritage. New Zealand Charter, it was, again, speak about many aspects, many social heritage, spiritual, so it's not connected only about movable or some Belt heritage. No, it's connected with other issues. While and this part I like it very much in Charter of Vernacular Architecture, which is issued by ICOMOS, that it called all values is something like bride of all people. So now we are speaking about a real connection between the people and the heritage itself or the heritage city. And of course, Bora Charter is again like New Zealand Charter, speak about social and spiritual values of the past. Theoretical approach, mostly the most important, because I know we are tight of time, so I will take just in the result, especially what is the most important, that the heritage of Egypt mainly lies in its creative cultural diversity. So we can't take the one side and we are speaking about one side, movable only or immovable only, or tangible or intangible. No, it has to be complete approach when we are dealing with heritage. Official charters and convention considered values as tangible and intangible components as a part of human dignity, and here is why livable. And this is a very important point, because when you speak about livable city, that means that we are, I think, like here in Paris, while we are enjoying to be inside World Heritage Site, make sure and take care that there are people living inside. It's not only a matter of tourism, no, it is livable, and this is when here we rejected the idea of transferring historic Cairo or Luxor as an open museum. We are not a museum. We are already livable city, and this is here when I want to clarify why we are joining the tangible and intangible together. And then we will go to the experimental approach. Which will be analysis of local community attitude between the local and universal. Local values for community is not, we are not classified as a economic or marketing resources, and while we have to deal in universal level because we are now in the World Heritage List officially since 1979, so it's not a source of marketing or business only. Plus, from the other side, don't blame community when it has a bad interaction between international institution, because they don't have the public awareness of what is the cultural tourism, what is the cultural heritage, and what it will be beneath to me as a community when I'm dealing on side World Heritage Area. So if we will take the scope of the universal value versus local or value analysis, the World Heritage is a product of globalization. So the idea of World Heritage, it came that it's a heritage of mankind. It's not a heritage of Egypt or heritage of UK or heritage of America, of Europe. No, it's a mankind heritage. So this is the scope which Universal speak about. World Heritage Site have to follow international standards. So we are, from time to time, of course, we are under monitoring to make sure that we are on track. Governmental partnership with local communities still unrealistic until now. So it's taking like we are the stakeholders and we know what's better for the city. Plus in maintaining the World Heritage values still the priority for the universal without maintaining the community behavior inside the society with World Heritage. So the inscription of heritage in the World Heritage List could be disadvantage for local community for somehow, and the government might use it a little bit as a political game to control the land use. So when we are trying to have an investment in a certain city, so okay, let's tell that it's antiquity and then let's take the land. So that's what we have to make sure when we are dealing with community inside that environment. Local versus universal. This is the opposite direction. Let's see from the side of the local what they see. The essence of local heritage lies in its livable original state. So as we see in the picture, it's already they are living inside, they are working inside. We still have crafts inside the old city. So this is why you can't just remove the people to make a new cafe or to make a new activity. Of course, you have to make services. You have to enhance the experience of visitors inside World Heritage Site, but without affecting the life of the local community. Both can live together, but we have to find how is the way. Plus, the heritage is not registered. Of course, it may lose. It can be not be managed well. So it has to be preserved anyhow, but preservation, it has no conflict with local communities' heritage as well. Here, when we come to need to compatible rule between local community and organizations together. And while we are speaking about cultural heritage through the globalization and universal significance, globalization helped in accepting the idea of heritage to the whole. So after a while, when the visitors start to come and local communities start to make crafts and choose their goods and the people start to buy from them, as we do in any heritage site, what we are doing this country, we have a certain place making tent or making a certain craft. So they start to feel that it's not harmful like we considered before. So this is where UNESCO underlined respecting the variety of cultures. So this respecting start to encourage communities to react with international idea of world heritage. And this is especially when the Declaration of Cultural Diversity on 2001 was issued and started even the community in very little scale. We hope it will be better culture to know about that declaration and to know that it's a part of the city culture, is their crafts and their attitude together. Experiment approach result while aiming to have what we can do inside World Heritage from our experience in dealing in that project. First of all, we have to raise the awareness of management programs. They don't have any idea about what is management. When we tell that we are going to manage community, like I took the note from Catherine before, that you are trying to deal with something like built heritage, but people manage in different way. Of course, we started to talk about them, we take their opinion, even we hire some of the local community to be the connection between site commissions and between the local community. Inclusion of conservation education in long-term goals, and of course Dr. Norris spoke about that again, that really I graduated from Faculty of Fine Arts to Architecture Department, and I didn't know anything about cultural heritage until I got a master program of urban heritage, and one by one I started to be on field. So while I'm educated, graduated from faculty, and I don't know what is cultural heritage till I graduated, how can I blame the ignorant people or someone didn't study or finish very early study stages? So we have to introduce conservation education inside. Plus we have to distribute graduate level of World Heritage Management, that to have a direct communication. We don't have all to be doctors on the site commissions. We will have a degrees on level of employment. Then we can have that direct connection, not to cut between the site commission from the up or the level of management and with the low level of management. Plus, we have to make the best of local community to introduce them under the authority supervision to work and to reuse the building. And this is really, we started very hard and it was very successful stories. The most important issue that we have to monitor what we are doing, because if we didn't design indicator, we can measure what is the state of conservation, what is the state of management, it will be after a while, it will be not really what we aimed for. So the monitoring system is very important as well. Last part, it will be about the case study approach. It's a historic Cairo, and this is, of course, the photo of the very, very lovely street. It's in between historic Cairo. It's called the Mu'izz al-Din al-Dam. World Heritage Historic Cairo. It was nominated on 1979, and it has its margin. It's a very huge city, which we hear facing a very big problem with the buffer zone, how to identify buffer zone and how to control the infill design control inside the city itself. So it's between Citadel and Ibn Tulun, Gamaleya. I will not go in depth because most of us will not know that margin. It was inscribed on World Heritage List under the criteria of four criteria. I will, of course, we know it all as World Heritage, but I will take the last criteria, which is already connected with what I'm telling, to be directly or concretely associated with livable events or tradition, beliefs or artistics or literary works of outstanding global significance. And here is already what it was Cairo, and this part is really, I speak about Naguib Mahfouz, he is one author, very famous in Egypt, and he just writing about that historic places. So this is why the criteria already connected to historic Cairo, it's a lot of evidence, a lot of history there, it's not just good or beautiful monuments. The analysis of nomination, it was already this structure, and it has, as I told you, layer. You can find the Coptic area inside the Muslim of Amr ibn al-As area, Muslim architecture, and just one street later you will find the Jewish museum. So it's really a layer, so we have to know that it's a very big issue, so it was inscribed under four criteria for that reason. The problem here is that we have, as we see on the three circles, that we have a world view and we have a national or local view, and then we have users. Users like you are coming to have a service, you have coming to have a good experience, and you have to find it. And I have to sleep, and I have to work, and I have to perform my duty as well inside while I'm already living there. So this is the three circles already we are inside on the community. And to approach the sustainability prospects for community of Cairo World Heritage as livable heritage, we have to adjust general policies and legals, monitoring and information management, and which is very good point because we have a little bit low leakage in that part. Technical support, and we, of course, every advice is most welcome all the time. Cooperation between national and international institutions, and which is already we doing under the umbrella of UNESCO and ICOMOS and ICRO. I will take just very short that it was that what we found, the state of conservation of historic Cairo when we started very early on the complete project. Of course, we are making conservation since centuries, but we didn't take the city as a city. We were, here is monument we can conserve and here is monument, but we started the complete or compatible project in the beginning of 1999. As we see that you can find that the people already even, they don't know what is the margin of the city. You can find that we find the big track, get on the gate, and it couldn't get out because it was already for pedestrian. It can't be carried inside. And of course, when someone tried to work in perfumes and then he caused that big fire, we saw it and he was about to destroy the monument itself. And the other one need to make his own sign, so when you are trying to see what is ornament on the facades, you will never see it because of that commercials all over. A big residential complex was done in Fustat. This is the Fustat, by the way, the lake of water now, because when you are making an all, we are engineers, or most of us engineers, they know how, when you are making a very deep foundation, so the water start to escape and it attack Fustat, and now Fustat is just lake of water. So this is all what we what we face on the city when we started the project. So we entered to improve the infrastructure. We started to make replacement of the bad network, which caused damage, big damage to the city, lowering the street level, which of course all the people, it has a deterioration on the supply, water supply network. So they start to make his home higher, you know, to raise the floor, not to be attacking with water. So we make it original and we fix it everything. Traffic control, which was a very big deal to make finally the valuable and deteriorated monuments not to be approaches with that pollution of cars or even with the very heavy vibration which cause a lot of cracks to many monuments. Development of design, urban design elements, even including lighting and seating and facades of their shop. Okay, if you need it, let's help you to make a compatible shape. It will be better if we work together, not to be to make something abstracting the monuments itself. And this is from the already project implemented. This is the same street what I'm telling about in Mu'izz al-Din Allah. Here what I want is, it's not a matter making a better facades and better environment. No, we miss someone, something in heritage of Cairo that we don't have public spaces. What I like when I came here, it's my first time to Paris, that it has a lot of public spaces. You can communicate with community while you have a space. But in Cairo, we are when we have a space, we make parking because we have a lot of cars. So this is the problem. So finally, we took that the people, they need to really to know about each other. They are sitting there. So I think we got it after a while. So we started to make that public spaces in our historic area. The final results of our case study approach and for the whole approach is together that we already working on preparing a risk map for historic Cairo to determine priorities of implementation, preparing a sustainable master plan for historic Cairo, raising public awareness through training programs, and we started hardly on that, but we still have a long way to go through, developing a system program for the poor people, to let them work, to drag them inside World Heritage as a source of their joy and source of their money and a source of work as well. Providing opportunities for non-official organization, which is very good point, because when we are working with the NGO, already they are from the local community and they are a little bit educated more than them. So when we are dealing with that, you are making your life easier. The conclusion that I want to reach finally is that the community inside livable heritage can be advantage or disadvantage. It's referred back to us. How can we use that what we have on site? According to the management plan, to achieve the balance between local and universal value, we can reach the conservation need. So it will be from both sides. You made what you want and you kept the universal, outstanding universal value from one side, or from the other side, it's a still livable heritage. It's a still had development duty. It still bring money and it's still the people's quality of life is better. Happy anniversary, CRCC, and thank you for your listening.
Merci, merci beaucoup à vous, Yasmine Sabri, pour cette présentation très intéressante sur le Caire qui montre ce que peut être une ville vivante où les couches de civilisation se succèdent, mais où celle d'aujourd'hui a une grande importance avec une forte pression sociale. Et vous avez montré comment on doit associer patrimoine matériel et patrimoine immatériel pour parvenir à une bonne approche et une bonne gestion de ces sites. Alors, avez-vous une ou deux questions ? On peut, voilà, on peut prendre un tout petit peu de temps pour quelques questions avant de passer à la suite, comme nous avons un intervenant de moins. Il n'y a pas de questions. Alors moi, j'avais une petite question, mais Yasmine est partie. Voilà, elle est là. Non, non, just a little question. You spoke about the monitoring of the sites using locals. What do you mean exactly? What type of...
Sorry, can you repeat the question, yes, please?
You have spoken about the monitoring of the site, okay, of the ancient Cairo.
Yes.
And you mentioned, I have just read the sentence, we made the monitoring using local, I understand, communities or people, etc. But how do you do it, and how what kind of tools do you use for that?
Look, we are done that bit before. It was the first in Iraq, in the heritage site called Samarra, if anyone familiar with that. It has a very little, you know, money-wise to be in World Heritage. So they hire the local to monitor with cameras, like this digital camera, to go around and to take photos in a certain time to visual monitoring. This is number one. What I already worked in, I was working on a palace of Islamic Mamluk era. It's called the Palace of Prince Taz. We were using community to make sure that all the shops it's already didn't harm. They are communicating, they have, you know, neighborhood with them. So when they started that someone is trying to digging, you know, that the idea, I need to know what they are searching downstairs. And really we are, we have a system in Islamic architecture, it's called cistern. Cistern, this is like a big water tank. The people start, you know, to be curious. We have, we are a people of already want to learn very fast. So they, I will surprise them, and they will tell them where is the cistern. So he start to try to find it his way, and of course this can be very harmful. So this is here with the local community. No, you shouldn't do something like that. You should back to a cistern community. Someone was very helpful, and he bring us his grandpa, and tell him, no. It was here a different kind of level of flooring. So if you remove that part, you may find something. And this is where we find the wheel. And when then we bring a diver, this diver get inside and open us the door from very far away. So this is where we are using community. And it's of course not like we are doing with satellite monitoring, and this is a very big issue, but it's very limited, but very useful as well.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You are welcome. Thank you.
Ah, finalement, il y a une question.
Yes.
Est-ce que vous pouvez vous présenter, s'il vous plaît?
Oui, je m'appelle Béatrice Bayerbel. Je suis restauratrice de peinture. Je suis très intéressée par ces problématiques. I wanted to in the continuation of your question, ask how do you identify within the community with whom you're going to work? How do you process?
But I will ask you to raise your voice because
oh,
I can.
Sorry.
I'm sorry. Again.
I wanted to know how do you identify within the community? I mean, Cairo is a huge place, or even heritage places, I imagine. I mean, how among the users, among the people who live there, how do you identify with whom you're going to work? Within the community, how do you pick out the people with whom you work? Are there, I don't know, collective reunions with where you can discuss at a local level, things like that? Or how?
I will tell you our little secret. When we try to get in communication with community, first of all, we have a party. Will be at night. Let's all come. So when you hear in Egypt that we have a party inside a historic place, all the people like the atmosphere of the place itself. So everyone is coming from all directions. So, and then here we start that, okay, we are talking about something like that. We have a little stickers. We make introducing, and there is a very good publication called Introducing Heritage to Young Generation. We organize a workshop that, okay, we have today a competition of drawing, who want to contribute, so everyone bring his children. So we have a lot of ideas, actually.
You're welcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you.